Welcome back to Strictly Politics. Still with us in the studio, Attorney Tomas Sequia, the spokesperson of Ombudsman Gutierrez, presidential spokesperson Edwin Lacerda, and Congressman Eric Colmenares, and also, of course, Professor June Salipsip. So we continue with the discussion. Sir, Secretary Lacerda, today the President said that if Ombudsman Gutierrez wants to testify against the former president in any cases that may be filed against her, he would welcome that.
Certainly we would welcome it, but first we can't force or compel her to testify. It's up to her own volition to do so.
Were there any feelers in the discussions that they had when she tendered her resignation that
there was none. That's precisely why Edsa Lagman is saying there must have been a quid pro quo, but actually there's none. There's no deal that was made. The purpose for the visit of the ombudsman was to submit her resignation. And certainly, but if she decides to testify in favor of the government, then that would be a welcome development for us.
Attorney Sequia, do you think that the ombudsman would be willing to testify?
Well, first of all, the issue of testifying never came up when you were discussing the pros and cons. It was not a factor. Now, as to whether she will be willing to testify, I think we would say that if a subpoena ad testificandum is issued, then she will comply with the subpoena because I may fail that under penalty of loyane. So she will have to comply with it. But as to she's willing, I think that might be a different statement. But she will comply with any subpoena issued.
Okay, yes. Well, that's good enough, I suppose. Sir, the Bayan Muna has plans, I think, of filing a criminal case against her?
Well, our legal theory has always been that the reason why Ombudsman Gutierrez is sitting on these cases is because she wants to protect President Arroyo. She was an obstacle to the prosecution, investigation and prosecution of President Arroyo. So now that she's removed, for us in Bayan Muna, the main accountability now is with the former president, Arroyo. So in terms of, we have an NBN-ZTE criminal complaint against President Arroyo now, and we're going to focus on that. So much as, of course, Ombudsman Gutierrez should be made accountable, but we're willing to share our evidence and our witnesses with the farmers, for example, who would want to file these cases. I've just been informed tonight that the farmers are indeed going to file a case against her, and that we are going to help them in that. The KMP, the Kilusang Magbubukid ng Pilipinas.
How soon do you expect that?
Well, I think there's some preparations that should be done. After all, the ombudsman is a lawyer herself, and it must be well prepared too. So for us in Bayan Muna, we give it to the farmers have more stake on the issue of fertilizer scam. For us, we go for the President Arroyo. The farmers can go for President Arroyo or the ombudsman. But the only thing that I'd like to stress here is that in the battle against impunity, not only are the perpetrators, the perpetrators or the ones charged or accused should be held accountable, of course, but also what I call this support structure of impunity, the people who whitewash cases, failed to investigate, failed to prosecute, they must also be made accountable. And that's why a comprehensive effort towards prosecuting and investigating these people must be done. And therefore, for me, Ombudsman Gutierrez must also be made to account.
Professor June, it's been said many times that Ombudsman Gutierrez is a stumbling block to the president's campaign against corruption. Do you think that there's going to be any more progress in the fight against corruption with her out of the way?
I think now that it's without her there, I think they can proceed more smoothly in the prosecution of these cases. However, I think she must also answer for some of the things that she has done or what she has not done, because I think it's a sin of omission. She didn't do anything much, and I think that's a failure of the office. So I think she must be held accountable for that. But at the same time, I think now with the new ombudsman, I think there will be a better prosecution, and I think it's going to be moving more smoothly.
Let's quickly talk about the cases still pending at the Office of the Ombudsman. The fertilizer fund scam was supposed to be a strong case against Ombudsman Gutierrez. The recommendation that was made by the Office of the Ombudsman to file plunder charges against Jokjok Bolante and Sito Lorenzo, that was made nearly 3 weeks ago. It still hasn't been filed at the Sandigan Bayan. What's your take on that?
During the preparations, I was busy calling Sandigan Bayan and the OSP. And they said, no, ina-amend pa pala, may mga mali-mali kasi. It took you 6 years to file this. At tapos, on the very last minute, you're going to amend it. So, para sa akin, that announcement of filing was for impeachment purposes. Mm-hmm. And secondly, may napansin nga na mga pagkakamali doon, like yung may kinasuhan pa na patay na, mm-hmm. etc. Right. Tapos, ang problem ko doon is parang si Yusek Bulante ang mastermind. Mm-hmm. Once it's filed, and nandiyan na yan, the mastermind, the real mastermind, could now claim later if she's accused. Mm-hmm. Na, you know, your theory was that he's the mastermind. So mm-hmm. why? But nobody would really believe that a certain Yusek can control the entire government machinery, dispense with 628 million pesos, at siya ang mastermind dito, lumuluhod lahat ng mayor, governor, congressman, at pati cabinet members. So, I think the filing of the resolution must be studied by the new ombudsman para masigurado na hindi ito defective information.
So
that's why the call
wait.
for a new ombudsman to be appointed immediately is very, very, very strong.
But in the meantime, Mr. Bulante and Mr. Lorenzo and all the others who are in that recommendation, they already know that there are plans to file plunder charges against them.
Yes.
Plunder is a non-bailable offense, and there is no whole departure order against them. Isn't anybody concerned that they might be, are they even still in the country?
Well, I'm a human rights lawyer, and I have always argued that only courts can issue whole departure orders. So kahit na si Jokjok Bulante is, of course, we believe, involved sa fertilizer scam, I wouldn't recommend naman that anybody can just hold him.
Mm-hmm,
pero sa akin, kaya dapat ma-file na rin yung kaso, and then, you know, the court can issue that whole departure order.
Mm-hmm.
But ito pa yung, there are many people now who may feel na baka cases will be filed against them. So, dapat mabilis din kasi all these people can actually go abroad immediately. Just like what Jokjok Bulante did many years ago.
Mm-hmm. Right, because there's no reason to hold them here.
Now, even Gerald Garcia can
absolutely,
go
and that was
abroad
my next
right now.
Question. What happens now? Sir, the palace has said that it would like the new ombudsman to withdraw the plea bargaining agreement.
We know
that right?
The president has expressed his sentiments on the plea bargaining agreement.
Mm-hmm.
The simple case of General Garcia willing to return 150 million. It's mm-hmm. 50 million is the amount for plunder.
Mm-hmm.
So that in and of itself should constitute plunder already.
Mm-hmm.
So the president is very concerned about that. So we would hope that the new ombudsman would revisit the plea bargaining agreement and have it withdrawn.
Mm-hmm.
But again, it's up to the new ombudsman, and we're not going to use that as a litmus test for the new ombudsman. What we require is for her to, as what the president said, dedicated, full conviction, is eager to prosecute to the best of his or her abilities.
I think you just slipped. Did you say her?
Yeah.
Yes, or her. Is that a confirmation? I heard her.
It's either. We have no, that's a good question. I've been asked by Newsbreak, and I've been asked by several reporters, if Justice Conchita Morales is a candidate. We haven't discussed it yet.
Mm-hmm.
The process is you have to inform the Judicial and Bar Council of the resignation. We've done that yesterday. We've sent the letter to the JBC,
mm-hmm.
and the JBC will make an announcement for the vacancy for mm-hmm. the position of ombudsman.
Mm-hmm.
Then names will be submitted to the JBC for the consideration and interview of the prospective occupant. So once they come up with a list, mm-hmm. and they'll pass it on to the president for his assent on the choices. Or there's a list of people to be recommended as ombudsman. So.
But so what happens in the meantime? What happens if the Sandigan Bayan rules on the plea bargaining agreement while there's no new ombudsman yet? Because it can happen any day now.
Well, actually, that's a strange thing here. As I mentioned a few days ago, the status of that case is really unclear to me.
Mm-hmm.
If it's Ombudsman Gutierrez promised, I think Senator Drilon
mm-hmm.
in the Senate that yes, I will have this reviewed, and you know, but in reality, can she really take it back? Has it been approved by the Sandigan Bayan? If the answer is no, then why did General Garcia? Why was he allowed to
post
get
bail.
Out of jail
right.
post bail?
Mm-hmm.
So, what happens now if the Sandigan Bayan disapproves it? So, General Garcia goes back to jail.
Mm-hmm.
And will the government give back the 130 million pesos that he gave?
Mm-hmm.
Parang hindi naman ata pwede yun, no?
So you're of the opinion that that's a done deal, even with a new ombudsman, that's not
gonna... I think the ombudsman Gutierrez was not very straightforward here, but I think that's a done deal.
Mm-hmm.
So otherwise, what's the bail for?
Right.
That's a really strange case, and for me, I really hope that the new ombudsman would still have the power to reverse it, and the Sandigan Bayan has the power to disapprove it. But I'm sure Gerald Garcia would claim na double jeopardy. He would claim na, what? I've already given you the...
There's no double jeopardy in this case because there's the consent of Garcia.
Okay.
So it's a requirement that there's no consent of the accused if double jeopardy will apply.
Uh-huh.
In this case, there was the consent secured from Garcia for the plea bargaining agreement.
But he will claim definitely that he was convicted. He'd serve his sentence.
So I suppose it remains to be seen, really, when
I'm
you have
sure
a new ombudsman.
He will claim that. Whether or not the Supreme Court will grant him, I mean, go up to the Supreme Court again. But it's weakening the case.
Uh-huh. But we have to take judicial notice of the fact that the Sandigan Bayan itself said that the plea bargaining agreement has not been approved.
That's right.
So
yes, I heard that.
That's
the strange part with the Sandigan Bayan. You haven't approved it, but you've
allowed him to post
what
bail.
If he goes out, no security,
etc. Still unclear. Now, at the Supreme Court also, another thing that's still pending is the motion for reconsideration with the Truth Commission. And it's been said before, sir, that the Truth Commission is supposed to be doing, or it's pretty much the same, has the same functions as the Office of the Ombudsman. So do you think, sir, Professor June, that with the new ombudsman, a new ombudsman coming in, is there still a need for the Truth Commission?
I think the Truth Commission, the way it was formed, it was supposed to produce a certain kind of image that it's composed of several people. It's not just one person, so that it projects the idea that it is well balanced. That's why even the selection of the people in that group was, I think, done more intensely.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the kind of thing that they'd like to project, that it is not really to prosecute someone, but it's really to find the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And so if it's the ombudsman, it's almost like looking for evidence to convict someone. I think when it comes to the Truth Commission, it's to really find out the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And then when they have the evidence, then other people can take care of the evidence and use that in court.
The Truth Commission was supposed to be a recommendatory body.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It investigates the scams, the scandals, and then it submits its recommendation to the ombudsman. This was also in anticipation of the fact that we're coming in with a ombudsman who appears not to be friendly to
right.
the new dispensation.
Right.
And so that's the reason why the president, during the campaign, was saying that we're forming a truth commission.
Right.
I really don't know now with the new ombudsman whether the president would still insist on a truth commission.
Right.
Because primarily, we believe that with a new ombudsman, we will be able to investigate the scandals properly.
So it may not be necessary.
We're not sure yet.
Anymore.
I still have to consult the president on his views on the matter.
Uh-huh. Okay. All right. The selection, we were talking earlier about the selection for the potential candidates for ombudsman. The JBC is going to come up with a list. Is that all that the president can choose from, or can he appoint somebody who's not in the list of the JBC?
We do it by way of nominating a person.